about a 24-hour battle, stretching from one day into the next.
We've been training for years, and this is our 4 minutes.
Every one of them gave their life in that rescue attempt, and they did it because one of their own was down.
Widely viewed as the world's combat elite, the clandestine U.S. Navy SEALs have found themselves in the media spotlight, as recent operations have brought these quiet warriors unaccustomed fame.
U.S. Navy SEALs rescued American cargo ship Captain Richard Phillips.
They're the superheroes, they're the titans, they're the impossible men doing an impossible job.
Much of their history is as secretive as their missions. But over the decades, the roles of SEALs and their frogmen forefathers have transformed along with evolving threats. And a 24-hour news cycle. From Hitler to Bin Laden. From countering massive armies to countering terror. From frogmen to high-tech commandos. How have the covert SEALs become the renowned warriors of today? Who are the men behind the face masks? Behind the green paint, behind the history. There are just 2,000 men today who are active duty U.S. Navy SEALs. They are all volunteers who endure what is perhaps the hardest military training in the world.
I think my Hell Week was just like everybody else's Hell Week and the 92 classes before me. And that's why we do Hell Week. First and foremost, so that you have confidence in yourself. You stay up for 120 hours during the week, and you get about 3 or 4 hours sleep. And the reason why you get 3 or 4 hours is because we've done studies, and if you don't get that minimum amount of sleep, you'll die after staying up for 120 hours.
Until you go through it, you don't understand what it can do to go grab your inner soul.
If you don't think you're the best SEAL, you don't need to be in the SEAL team.
It's a real job, and it hurts. And it breaks people, mentally, physically, it does all of that.
In the movies, they make it look like everything goes as planned, but no mission ever goes exactly the way you plan it. So you have to be able to adapt.
That's the $1 million question. Why do you want to be a frogman? Because they're gonna pay me and let me skydive and blow up? Well, if you could be part of a team, wouldn't you want to be a part of the very best in the entire world?
While fewer than 10,000 men have ever been Navy SEALs, they greatly define the modern battle space. Small groups of highly trained, well-equipped commandos facing off against terrorist enemies. The Taliban, Iraqi insurgents, Al-Qaeda, and Osama bin Laden.
The reputation that the community has isn't because of anything I've ever done. It's because of what everybody came before me, everybody who's gone after me, and that collective talent is now pulled onto an emblem that's on your chest.
The SEALs' forerunners have always been state of the art for their day. The generic term for all naval special warfare swimmers is frogmen. Allegedly because of how their British colleagues looked in their newly fashioned green wetsuits. Others recall it's how the divers appeared once they were issued some exciting new high-tech gear, swim fins.
What do I think about my frogman forefathers? It's just unbelievable what they did with what they had. When I think about guys fighting the Japanese with a K-bar and a bag of explosives, it's unbelievable when I think about the things they did.
The
older generation of frogmen did so much with so little. They had to rely on their ingenuity and kind of their working class hero kind of person, you know, that's who they were, tough guys.
The guys who were the forefathers, they're going out to go ahead and clear a beach, and the guys who went out before them didn't come back. And so now these guys are putting their hand up and saying, I'll still go. That's the kind of people that are still coming in to the SEAL community.
SEAL is an acronym, meaning sea, air, and land. It's how and where they operate. So how did naval special operations teams also become land-based commandos?
It's a Cinderella story. It doesn't make sense that a Navy unit would be doing the types of things that we're doing. It doesn't make sense that a Navy unit would be in Afghanistan or in the middle of Iraq, completely separated from a body of water. It just doesn't make sense. The fact that we are there, the fact that we're doing those types of missions, it's all related to how we evolved.
The SEALs were born in World War II, of two oceans, for two kinds of demolition work. In the Pacific, their predecessors swam in advance of U.S. Marines and Army troops, removing underwater obstacles to make amphibious landings possible. And in the Atlantic, teams were needed on the beaches of France to blow open the gateway to Europe for D-Day.
Everybody knows that the invasion is going to happen in France. They know that they're going to have to put millions of men onto the coast to unseat Hitler, to defeat the German armies in France.
The Allies would have to land somewhere along the coast of France. They knew that Hitler had built a massive Atlantic wall to prevent the invasion and that they would have to find a way to breach it. But on the eve of its entry into World War II, the U.S. military had no one with expertise in this kind of complex demolition work. The U.S. Navy would recruit a 31-year-old expatriate, Draper Kaufman. He would help create one of the forefather teams of today's Navy SEALs. When the nearsighted Kaufman graduated from the Naval Academy, he failed to get a commission in the U.S. Navy. But by the late 1930s, France and England were at war with Germany, years before America entered the fray. So he went overseas to serve, becoming an ambulance driver. After a brief stint as a German prisoner of war, he went to London to join the fight there.
The Blitz is going on this entire time. Hundreds of people are getting killed in London, you know, every other day. Bombs are falling. Some bombs are not exploding. They ask for volunteers for bomb disposal. I'm true to form, Draper volunteers. Yeah, he's a character. For whatever reason, he wants to be as close to the center of action as he possibly can.
Kaufman's experience with ordnance got him a transfer from the British Navy to the American one. His orders to start the U.S. Navy's bomb disposal unit came just in the nick of time.
Days after Draper Kaufman returns to the U.S. Navy, the Japanese attack Pearl Harbor.
Shortly after the Japanese attack on Hawaii, Kaufman was ordered to dismantle an unexploded 500-pound bomb in Pearl Harbor. For his valor, he was awarded the Navy Cross. He returned to Washington, D.C. to run the Navy's bomb disposal school. Then, in 1943, while on his honeymoon, Lieutenant Commander Kaufman received orders to report back to D.C.
After 4 days of honeymoon, we were at the Hotel New Yorker, and I got a telegram telling me to report immediately, and I did what I guess anybody else would have done. I gave the young bellboy $5 and said, "Son, you can't find me. Come back tomorrow."
When he arrived in Washington, Draper Kaufman was given his new assignment, clear Hitler's beaches.
Have you ever seen intelligence pictures of the obstacles the Germans are building on their beaches in France? I said, "No, sir." He said, "Well, they're putting obstacles out in 6 feet of water. It would stop the landing craft there, and the soldiers would have to get out in 6 feet of water. Do you know how much an infantryman's pack weighs?" And I said, "No, sir." Said, well, neither do I, but they'll all rob. Said, now, I want you to put a stop to that.
Kaufman's new mission took him from running a school on disposing unexploded bombs to exploding ones. He was ordered to create the Naval Combat Demolition Units, or NCDUs.
By his own accounting, he didn't have a clue what he was doing. But he took some of his officers with him, and those officers are actually the one that set everything up and made it work.
For their training camp, the men went to a swampy outpost in Fort Pierce, Florida.
There was no air conditioning out there. There was no off mosquito repellent. They said they would rather face the Germans than the mosquitoes and the no-see-ums out there. The training that still happens at BUDS, which is basic underwater demolition SEAL training, started right here in Fort Pierce. So every time you see a guy is lifting up a log, that started right here at Fort Pierce. Boat teams going out through the waves, that started right here in Fort Pierce. The term Hell Week started right here in Fort Pierce because Draper Kaufman wanted to condense the training because he was getting ready for war. So he said, let's get this all done in a week. And they called it Introduction Week. The guys called it Hell Week.
Kaufman's trying to create as close a representation of actual war as possible. When the Second World War starts, Draper Kaufman is probably the one American that has seen the most of it. He's seen how horrible war is. He's seen the emotional and physical toll that it takes on you. So when he creates this NCDU training, he's trying to get as close to that experience as possible. He's trying to show they can go without sleep for a long period of time. They can be cold and miserable and hungry and everything else.
Kaufman used instructors from his bomb disposal unit to help transform Navy construction battalions, or Seabees, into naval combat demolition units. Men from the Scouts and Raiders, a joint Army-Navy maritime reconnaissance unit, were in charge of the physical training that created Hell Week. According to one of the original NCDU officers, Hell Week separated the men from the boys. The men took off and left us with the boys. But the boys who stayed turned out to have the intrepid spirit for this kind of work.
Our first class started, I think, with about 200, and we graduated about 70.
NCDU training began on June 6, 1943. The trainees didn't know it at the time, but exactly 1 year later, these men would be on the beaches of Normandy on D-Day.
Naval combat demolition men were put together to get rid of the obstacles on beach approaches in Europe, specifically Normandy. There's a very high tidal shift at Normandy, so sometimes the obstacles are underwater. Sometimes they're not underwater, and if you're going to eliminate the obstacles, you really have to get in there and get them at low tide.
Much has been told of the D-Day invasion and the sacrifices made on these bloodstained beaches. But the story of the naval combat demolition men, forefathers of today's SEALs who helped make the invasion possible, has lived mostly in the shadows of history. 18-year-old Ken Reynolds was one of the men who volunteered for the NCDUs.
I thought, and other people thought, it meant non-combat demolition. And my mother was elated because it was non-combat. But I soon found out that that's not what it meant.
The Seaman Second Class went to England to join about 100 naval combat demolition volunteers who were already training. Allied engineers in England had reproduced the German beach obstacles so the NCDU men could practice exploding them. One of the obstacles that the NCDUs would have to defeat was called a Belgian gate. An officer named Carl Hagensen prepackaged 2-pound charges of C2 explosives that could be quickly wrapped around the beach obstacles. Engineers determined that these Hagensen packs had to be placed in 16 strategic spots, in order to flatten the metal tank trap in a way that would allow Allied vehicles to drive over the former obstacles. The NCDU men, along with Army engineers, were assigned to gap assault teams, each one responsible for blowing 50-yard breaks in the beach defenses at Normandy. If they failed, it would jeopardize the largest invasion in history. Early on the morning of June 6, 1944, the NCDUs pulled their explosive-laden rubber boats as close to the obstacles as possible.
You knew what was in back of you. There was thousands and thousands of ship coming across the channel. And if we didn't open up the beach, there was nowhere to go.
Some of the Army soldiers advancing towards Normandy looked at the hell in front of them, their fellow troops being massacred by German defenses on Omaha Beach. And they clung to the obstacles that Ken and the other demolitioners had already wired. Ken tried, sometimes in vain, to get the soldiers to loosen their suicide grips on the German defenses.
We got about half of all the obstacles charged, and the Army decided that they were going to come in. You'd take a fuse lighter and you'd pull it, and so you've got 2 minutes to get out of here. But some of them didn't move. They were so scared that they didn't know what to do.
Despite suffering a 52% casualty rate, the NCDU men, alongside the Army combat engineers, were able to blast completely open 5 of the 16 corridors assigned to them and 3 more partial gaps. But that was enough to allow the landings at Omaha Beach and the Allied forces to pursue Hitler's army.
We were an expendable unit. If you survived, well and good. Boy, you survived. If you died, well, we're sorry. Nobody knew who we were. The only identification we carried was on our helmet, which says USN on the helmet. So consequently, we were there by ourselves. But we were there, very much so we were there.
One of the reasons that the NCDU remained invisible to history is that they would only serve in 2 significant operations in Europe, D-Day and the invasion of southern France. And once U.S. troops were on the ground in Europe, demolition work shifted completely to the war in the Pacific. Battles in the Pacific Ocean posed very different challenges than the land war now raging in Europe. The fight against Japan was all about U.S. amphibious island landings. American military leaders decided the best way to advance towards Tokyo was to implement an island-hopping campaign, skipping the enemy's largest strongholds while capturing other islands that would allow them to hopscotch across the Pacific. It began in the fall of 1943 at a place called Tarawa. This would be the first major test of the combined Navy-Marine Corps ability to capture an island fortress in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. It would also be the place where the need for underwater demolition men became tragically apparent.
Tarawa was the first major amphibious assault in the Pacific, and they were using photographic interpretation of what the coral reefs looked like or what beaches they were going to land on. What they discovered was that the boats hit these coral reefs far from the beach, and many of the Marines had jumped out. Hundreds of Marines drowned. So they knew that they had to have some sort of pre-assault reconnaissance. That's when they established the 2 provisional UDTs. UDT stands for Underwater Demolition Team.
After the Marines suffered more than 3,000 casualties in the 76-hour battle to take Tarawa, UDTs would subsequently be used in advance of every major amphibious landing in the Pacific. Unlike their NCDU brothers at D-Day, these men worked underwater. History has dubbed them the Naked Warriors.
The Naked Warrior was the UDT operator in the Pacific who went to the beach just in swim trunks, a K-bar knife, a slate around his neck, and a stubby pencil, to take a streamlined reconnaissance of the beach, taking depth soundings and then recording it on their slates. They were the Naked Warrior.
These barely armed men made a critical difference in the victories at places like Saipan, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa. Other maritime commandos operated for the Office of Strategic Services, precursor of the CIA. Their missions included infiltration behind enemy lines and sabotage. Of all the forefathers of the SEAL teams, the covert OSS Maritime Unit pushed the limits of technology.
The Lambertson lung that was used by OSS Maritime was very innovative in its time. It was a closed circuit, pure oxygen breathing apparatus that essentially took exhaled air and spread it over a bed of chemicals that recirculated it back to the diver. And this, in essence, created a bubble-free diving apparatus. They adopted the first usable submersible from the British, which was called Sleeping Beauty. It was called a submersible canoe. It was a one-man vessel that could be propelled on the surface and then submerged for the attack. They developed a floating mattress that was propelled. And they used an electric drill with a 12-volt battery to propel two guys through the water with it.
As the underwater demolition teams prepared for an invasion of mainland Japan, President Harry Truman changed the course of history. Two atomic weapons ended the war in the Pacific.
Thousands of proud American flags dotted the square, and as the day wore on, hilarity reached a high peak.
As happens after war, the military immediately began downsizing. The OSS Maritime Unit would not survive, nor would the scouts and raiders, nor the Naval Combat Demolition Units. All but a handful of UDTs were disbanded. Still, young men were drawn to becoming Navy frogmen.
I saw the movie, The Frogman, with Richard Whitmore. I was a very good athlete at the time, and I was a good swimmer.
The movie was Frogman. I had said at the end of that movie, that's what I'm going to do when I get a little bit older.
The movie came out, the Frogman movie with Richard Widmark, and I thought, well, I'll just go down and become a frogman. That's when I went down and joined the Navy.
Despite young men's ambitions, the underwater demolition teams shrank from 3,100 men at the end of the World War to 200. The nature of warfare in the late 1940s chilled, from hot battles against the Axis of Germany, Japan, and Italy, to the Cold War between the Democratic West and the Communist East. What some have described as hysteria gripped much of the United States over fear of communist infiltrators. Called the Red Scare because of adherents' devotion to the flag of the USSR, it prompted President Truman to issue a loyalty order requiring government employees to be investigated for adequate allegiance to the United States of America. In 1949, the Soviets successfully tested a nuclear weapon. And communist forces led by Mao Zedong overtook China. Then, in 1950, the Cold War boiled over.
On Sunday, June 25th, communist forces attacked the Republic of Korea.
It was the first major combat of the Cold War. When 75,000 Soviet-backed North Korean troops poured south into the Republic of Korea, an American ally, President Truman responded by sending U.S. forces to stop the advance of the communists. The American military started arriving in Korea within weeks, and the underwater demolition teams were in the fight once again. Korea marked a transformation for the UDTs. This would be the first time they moved inland beyond their traditional Navy maritime habitat. But their missions were still mostly nautical, often keeping passageways for American ships open. Wonsan Harbor in North Korea had been heavily mined before U.S. and United Nations navies enforced a blockade. But it required constant vigilance from the underwater demolition teams to keep it from being further mined by the North Koreans. A former World War II scout and raider turned UDT man, Dick Lyon, was assigned a dangerous new mission in Wonsan Harbor. His commanding officer called the 28-year-old lieutenant into his office.
Yes, he said, I have to have the strongest swimmer. I've just received an indication that a new shallow water mine has been dispensed inside of Wonsan Harbor. You're going to be heavily armed with a pair of 24-inch bolt cutters, and your job is to dive down under the mine and cut the mooring cable. It was before we had any issued scuba gear, which is why I was freebie going down with bolt cutters and a K-bar. So that's it.
Dick Lyon entered the 36-degree water with no experience or training in mine warfare. And no American had ever confronted this kind of mine before.
I swam down under the mine with my bolt cutters, making sure that I don't do something really cuckoo, like break one of those horns, because that's the last thing I would ever remember.
Inside one of the mines that Dick Lyon recovered was its packing slip in Russian. It's not clear why a receipt would be inside a mine, but it was clear. The Soviets were supplying these weapons to the North Koreans. The Cold War was in full swing.
It came on July 27, 1953. While the communists signed at Panmunjom, General Clark, in ceremony...
After 3 years of fighting, the Korean conflict ended in a stalemate in 1953. But once an armistice was signed, the United States entered another period of military evolution. President Dwight Eisenhower, the former general, was careful not to dismantle the military as had happened after World War II, but he now based his strategies around nuclear capabilities. As the Strategic Air Command patrolled the skies 24 hours a day, while nuclear submarines plied the oceans. The tides of warfare were shifting to the concept of mutually assured destruction, or MAD. The theory was that if two opposing sides each had enough nuclear firepower to destroy the other, then neither would fire their weapons because there could be no victor in such a conflict. Only equal, shared destruction. The massive nuclear buildup was designed to contain both the Soviet Union and China. But those adversaries were now using a very different strategy, spreading communism through smaller guerrilla wars in countries like Laos. U.S. military and political leaders were concerned about what was known as the domino effect. One country falling to communism, triggering the next one to fall. So they were determined to draw a line in the sand without launching nuclear missiles. In 1958, an admiral named Arleigh Burke came up with a plan for special warfare teams that would be the blueprint for what the U.S. Navy SEALs would one day become.
Now, Arleigh Burke was the chief of naval operations. He felt that the services had to be alert to the changing national threat and be able to create operations that were something less than nuclear war. And so he was the one, if anyone would be considered the Papa SEAL, Arleigh Burke would be Papa SEAL.
Although Admiral Burke conceived the plans for unconventional naval warfare under the Eisenhower administration, it would be a new president who would champion them.
John F. Kennedy settles into office as the 35th president of the United States.
14 days before Kennedy's inauguration, the Soviets had announced they would be advancing wars of liberation to spread communism. It was in this tense climate that John Kennedy was about to take Arleigh Burke's vision of SEAL teams and make it a reality. In the same speech that Kennedy announced the plan to have an American on the moon by the end of the decade, he also declared the need for enhanced special warfare capabilities, laying out his vision for the decade to come.
To expand rapidly and substantially, in cooperation with our allies, the orientation of existing forces for the conduct of non-nuclear war, paramilitary operations, and sublimited or unconventional wars.
A little more than 7 months after this speech, the U.S. Navy established SEAL Teams 1 and 2. As is still the case, odd number teams are on the West Coast and even number teams on the East Coast. Although the underwater demolition teams would continue on with their strictly maritime mission of clearing beaches for amphibious landings, every man on the first SEAL teams was pulled from the UDTs.
Well, we had heard rumors because they'd been working on putting something together, but we had absolutely no knowledge that anything was imminent. And we didn't really know what SEAL team was going to be. I'm not sure anybody did at that point.
First of all, I got to tell you, I was like halfway through my training before I found out there were SEALs there. I have heard of them before, but I thought they was talking about a little furry creature that swam around in the harbor. So I didn't, really pay that much attention to SEALs. I just wanted to be a frogman.
First time I heard the term SEAL use was in late 1961, and most of us thought that the SEALs stood for Southeast Asia Liaison. It seemed to fit. But we soon found out it stood for sea, air, land, and would take us beyond the capabilities of UDT.
A 29-year-old lieutenant named Dave Del Judas was selected as the first commanding officer of SEAL Team 1. Considering the sophisticated operations the teams have today, these were humble beginnings.
We were only 10 officers and 50 enlisted at that time. We didn't even have a building to work out of. So we had to start from scratch and get everything organized, not only equipment, but a place to call home. I had almost no guidance at the beginning of SEAL Team 1. It was a question of trying to learn as we went along how best to fulfill the mission.
The mission would be Vietnam. Just 10 days after SEAL Team 1 was formed, Dave Del Judas and one of his officers, John Stockholm, were on their way to Southeast Asia, where guerrilla warfare was already widespread. Saigon's military was no match for the communist Viet Cong, and the Kennedy administration was concerned that the VC would soon vanquish America's ally in the South. The first SEALs in Vietnam did not fight, they advised. Although the teams arrived in 1962, they would not operate in combat missions in Vietnam until 1966. Instead, they trained their South Vietnamese counterparts for CIA-planned missions into North Vietnam. The early 60s found the SEALs and CIA as partners in formulating covert operations against the communist North. The CIA picked the targets, and the SEALs worked out the military tactics. In addition to working with the CIA on intelligence, the SEALs collaborated with technological experts. In 1964, American scientists began working on a secret weapon for the SEALs, the extraordinary new device, a miniature nuclear bomb. Known as backpack nukes, these weapons were built as an alternative to the massively destructive nuclear weapons in the U.S. arsenal. These little nukes were called B-54 Special Atomic Demolition Munitions, or SADMs. A handful of SEALs trained to parachute in with a 58-pound device, infiltrate behind enemy lines, and have the capability of annihilating an entire battlefield. A pair of swimmers could also insert into an enemy-held area, plant the bomb, and swim back out. Despite their size, some of these nuclear weapons were more powerful than the one dropped on Hiroshima. Other than in testing, The SATM was never detonated during the 25 years it was in the military's arsenal. Some team members interviewed to train with the device were uncomfortable working with its potential devastation, saying they'd rather go back to Vietnam. Vietnam, 1966. It would be here and now that the SEALs would establish their reputation as true combat warriors. The North Vietnamese were successfully building an insurgency in the South. At the same time, the CIA realized there was little hope of creating meaningful resistance in the North. A detachment of SEALs were sent in to take direct action against Viet Cong guerrillas who had infiltrated the South. Operationally, the SEALs worked almost autonomously. They would gather their own intel and plan their own counterinsurgency missions. They also chose their own equipment.
It changed from being this guy in the water with fins on and a face mask and a life jacket and a K-bar to a guy with an AR-15, M-16, machine guns going in and going directly against the enemy.
The first SEALs in combat wore Marine Corps green uniforms and camouflage uniforms when they could get them. And a lot of the later SEALs wore camouflage tops and Levi's, more comfortable. They also wore pantyhose, by the way, keep the leeches off of you when you're going through the canals.
These men are members of one of the most unique military organizations in history. Behind these green faces are men who have accepted the challenge of some of the most daring assignments given to American fighting men. These are the Navy's SEALs.
The men with green faces was a term that came out at the start of Vietnam, because we used to use this camouflage makeup on our faces and everything, and a lot of it was green and black, and used to scare the living daylights out of the Vietnamese to have you pop up and wake some guy up in his hooch and be looking at him. It almost put him in shock.
Of course, back then everybody knew that that stuff didn't work worth a damn, and it'd wash off after you sweated so much in the jungles. It would be gone, you'd be the guys with the white faces or the dark brown tan faces, you know.
We started out with the simple missions, just to kind of get used to the terrain and acclimate, you know, the weather there and the bugs and the creepy crawlies and the caimans. God, these caimans, you know, saltwater alligators, they come out of nowhere.
I was put in charge of a 14-man SEAL platoon on the edge of the Rungsat Special Zone, which controlled the seaborne approaches to Saigon from the South China Sea. We had rules of engagement, but there was nothing, I recalled, no restriction whatsoever. In fact, it was a playground. My SEAL platoon, we had the weapons we needed. We had helicopters to insert us, boats to insert us and extract us, helicopters to shoot for us if we got in trouble, intelligence assets, and basically it was, okay, Lieutenant Woolard, here's the Rungsat, stop these guys from mining it, just go out and do it.
The name Rungsat translates as killer swamp, and in 1966, it was a dangerous VC stronghold located deep in South Vietnam. Yet the enemy's strength was hidden in the shadows of the jungle, in their ability to ambush. Lieutenant Maynard Wires led a SEAL platoon that was supposed to keep the Viet Cong from using this area as a supply route.
Saigon thought that there was a lot of stuff coming from there. There weren't any U.S. troops down there, or there weren't many, and so it was up to us to go in there and find them and destroy them.
28-year-old Billy Machen was one of the men in Lieutenant Wires' platoon. They had been through hand-to-hand combat school together and were close friends.
Billy Machen was with a platoon, and we were spending a lot of time in this particular area. We found several caches of rice in buildings, and so we destroyed them. The helicopters were flying above us. They indicated they saw a VC camp and some boats and stuff. They said that it would probably be good to check it out, and so I talked to the platoon that Machen was in. I said, hey, we need to go in and check this out. And Billy said to me, he said, well, do you think we should? They know we're around and this may not be too smart. And I said, yeah, I understand that. I said, but we'll have the helicopters above us for support, so it'll be okay. They got about halfway to the site And the helicopters called us on the radio and said that we're running out of gas, we got to go home. And so they took off, and we were halfway to the target, and they kept going, and then they got ambushed on the way in there, and Meacham got killed. It was tough to take because, first off, he got killed in there, and then, you know, we'd always bring our people back. One of the guys picked him up and carried him out, and it was touch and go, but they were able to get back to the boat with everybody intact except for Billy. It was a tough loss.
Despite the SEALs' growing reputation as invincible commandos, Billy Machen proved they were quite mortal. He was the first Navy SEAL combat death of the Vietnam War. But as the teams expanded their direct action missions, he would not be the last. A CIA-backed ongoing operation would cost five SEALs their lives as they led local forces and mercenaries on missions to capture or kill Viet Cong leadership. Provincial reconnaissance units, known as PRUs, were run under the CIA's infamous Phoenix Program, an initiative to destroy the Viet Cong infrastructure.
When the North and South separated, the North kept a parallel government in South Vietnam, and the idea was to go kill off this parallel government, the province chief, the governors, the tax collectors. It kind of got a bad name of being an assassination outfit.
We were trying to gather intel. It's one of the main things you want to do. If you can capture them without killing them, you're ahead of the game. For most cases, we were trying to capture them.
I think there were 60 SEALs totally that were involved, and no one knew we were SEALs. We had special ID cards and were kept quiet. And some of the reason is I was telling Army majors what to do, and little did they know that it was an E6 enlisted SEAL that was telling them what to do. We had a lot of power, and it was very effective and also very dangerous.
According to the CIA, the provincial reconnaissance units became probably the most controversial element of Phoenix. The CIA used their existing network of over 100 South Vietnamese district intelligence committees to compile lists of known Viet Cong infrastructure, or VCI, operatives. These targets' identities were sent to special forces, police, and the PRUs. The stated preferred goal was to neutralize the VCI on the list by capturing and interrogating them. But if they resisted, which apparently thousands did, they were killed.
There's a degree of it that's uncomfortable because I was told to not talk about it for a long time. At one point, I was an assistant principal in a high school, and I didn't really want the kids to know what my past was. They knew I had been in SEAL team, but I never really talked about what I did. There are parts that I'm uncomfortable with. I think any time that a warrior starts talking about combat, there's a part of that person will go back into that, and I don't want to go there.
SEAL contact with the enemy was close and personal, often operating just inches from their targets. Their direct actions were considered the most effective anti-guerrilla operations in the war. The last SEAL platoon left Vietnam on December 7, 1971. By then, two-thirds of America's troops had been pulled out. By early 1972, the ground war was now mostly the responsibility of the South Vietnamese. But a handful of SEAL advisors did remain, and men like Lieutenant Tom Norris were still operating on critical, dangerous missions. On April 2, 1972, a U.S. electronics jamming plane was shot down in an area that was occupied by thousands of North Vietnamese troops. Only the navigator, 53-year-old Lieutenant Colonel Isiel Hambleton, survived the crash. Also, a crewman from another plane, Lieutenant Mark Clark, was alive on the ground after being shot down. Clark had been trying to rescue Hambleton, who possessed U.S. nuclear weapons information. Secrets that would be of great value to the enemy if he were captured. The mission to save Hambleton, whose call sign was Bat-21, was memorialized in a book and movie. When Tom Norris undertook the rescue mission, 12 airmen had already died trying to save Hambleton. Rescue helicopters kept being shot down in the North Vietnamese-controlled area. But Norris was able to walk in and snatch Lieutenant Clark from the riverbed where he was hiding. Then Tom Norris headed back into the heavily patrolled enemy area to save Lieutenant Colonel Hambleton.
I was talking to the forward air controllers, and they were telling me that Hambleton is not making his scheduled calls to them. And when he is, he's not very coherent, and they think he's losing, he's not going to make it. So I said, okay, we're going to go after him.
Tom Norris and his South Vietnamese partner, Kiet, traveled by sampan to blend in with the local river traffic.
And we came out of the fog just below the Cam Lo Bridge, which is supposed to have been disabled. It was not. But it told me exactly where I was.
Tom didn't know it at the time, but there were 30,000 North Vietnamese troops crossing the Cam Lo Bridge.
From that, I had a pretty good idea where to start looking for him because the forward air controllers had seen him and they had been able to get a location on him from that. Got to an area where I thought looked pretty good. Reached the sampan, climbed up on the bank and started looking, and guy was 25 yards off the bank sitting there in a bunch of shrubbery, you know. And when he saw me, of course, he lit up and he started smiling and waving, and I went. So we loaded him on the sand, put a couple of life vests on him, put him in the bottom sandpan, put a bunch of vegetation on him. Kit got in the front, I got in the back, and we headed off on downstream.
Racing towards their base, the men were spotted by the North Vietnamese. But Norris and Kiet kept paddling furiously along the far side of the river, trying to outdistance the enemy when they came under withering machine gun fire. Norris called in air support. The men finally reached the safety of their camp. Doctors later reported that Hambleton, who had lost 45 pounds over his 11 and a half day ordeal, could not have lasted much longer. And as it had for over 10 years, the Vietnam War bled on. In Paris, President Richard Nixon's National Security Advisor, Henry Kissinger, was in peace talks with the North Vietnamese. To give him more leverage, all military options were on the table, including a massive amphibious landing near the North Vietnamese border. Two of the few SEALs left in country undertook a reconnaissance mission. Lieutenant Tom Norris, who 6 months earlier made the Bat-21 rescue, and Petty Officer Mike Thornton were joined by three South Vietnamese special operators. Norris, who was scheduled to go home in about a week, hand-picked Mike Thornton for the operation.
Mike's the kind of guy that you think a SEAL should be. He's the big, muscular, you know, I am a SEAL. The rest of us are, I mean, in actuality, most of them are my size. They're not big guys at all. They're tough, you know, average-sized folks.
Tom and Mike's mission called for them to reconnoiter an enemy-held naval base on the Qua Viet River and see how heavily defended it was. Was it vulnerable to being captured for a possible amphibious landing site?
I planned to go up with the Vietnamese, and they were going to drop us off into small little rubber rafts, called inflatable baits, small as IBSs. And we were going to paddle into an area and then offload from the IBSs and swim into the beach and do our patrol and then come back out again.
The SEALs did not know it at the time, but their Vietnamese boat driver inserted them far north of their intended drop point.
We slipped in the water and swam to the beach. Tommy sent me up over. I had a starlight scope, went up over the beach, looked both ways to make sure the areas were clear. Couldn't see the Qua Viet, but we brought everybody up over the beach one at a time.
The men did not find the river where they were supposed to be, but as dawn was about to break, they spotted something ominous.
And we're looking around, and Mike says, he called me nasty. He says, "Hey, nasty, is that what I think it is up there in the hill?" And I said, "If you're talking about that tank, yeah, absolutely." And he said, "Okay, just thought I'd check, you know." We're fine where we are, but you know, they're up there, we're down here, it's okay. And it didn't end up that way. There was a patrol that came down the beach, and the officer that was with us decided that they thought it would be a good idea to see if we could do a body snatch.
He stood up behind the sand dunes and yelled, "Lie day, my land, lie day, my land," means come here.
Tried to call the guy over.
The guy's got an AK-47. He's got this little... and this guy's 100 yards away from him. And
things went from bad to worse. You know, we got in a tremendous firefight.
The South Vietnamese officer's decision to attempt to capture an enemy soldier by shouting at him ended up alerting the North Vietnamese to the Americans' presence. The two SEALs and the three South Vietnamese operators found themselves overwhelmed by a force of roughly 300.
They had dunes all up here, so I would move up here and shoot, and then I'd fall back and shoot, and I'd roll over here and throw a grenade over there, and then I'd shoot. But, you know, by me moving around, it gave them a false pretense as how many people
we had. We had a lot more people.
Shooting and maneuvering. Yeah.
After a three-hour firefight, the North Vietnamese troops began to pull back. But the SEALs realized that their enemy was not retreating, merely repositioning to surround them. Tom Norris used his radio to call in an American destroyer to bombard their position.
"We're going to be an overrun. You know, this is what I need, and I want you to fire for effect." Of course, to them, that means you're throwing rounds right on top of us. And the guy comes back and he says, "Understand fire for effect?" And I said, "Absolutely, put it on us." And he said, "Are you sure?" And I said, "Get it in here." And they did. I mean, they brought it in, thank goodness. I mean, it was a long time coming. I mean, as soon as I said, "Mike, we're extracting," we started leapfrogging out of there, and I'm the last guy up there, so I'm covering those guys until it's my turn to leapfrog out, and that never happened because I got shot. I mean, I knew I'd been hit, but I didn't, you know, I didn't know how bad. I mean, I knew it, and so I'm scrounging around to find my rifle to try and, you know, shoot back, and yeah, I'm seeing tunnel vision come in, and I'm fighting and going, no, because I need to shoot. I mean, I need to cover my guys, and boom, I went out.
Later on, I see Dane coming back by himself. I said, "Where's Tom?" He said, "Mike Dowie's dead." And I said, "Stay here." And they both grabbed me, and I said, "Stay here, I'll go get Tommy." I thought he was dead, but I wasn't going to leave him behind. That was a thing that we never leave anybody behind, so I sure wasn't going to be the first one.
When Mike got to Tom's position, it was being overrun by the enemy.
I eliminated several other guys coming over the pop. Then I picked him up and started running, and that's when the first round hit, and we got blown in the sky. And I fell, and I saw him flying off my shoulders. When I picked up Tommy, he said, "Mike, buddy," and that's when I knew he was back alive.
I had blood all over my face. I mean, I had my brain hanging out, and I don't know what all. Bad guys just shooting at us. And I could see rounds hitting the water, going ching, 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 you know? And pretty soon, I'm kind of losing consciousness again, and Mike's trying to pull me out to sea.
Shot through his leg and hit with shrapnel in his back, Mike Thornton was now swimming two injured comrades out to sea. Tom Norris, who was barely alive, and one of the South Vietnamese operators who'd also been shot and couldn't swim. Mike carried them both for several hours before they were finally picked up.
The doctor gave him no chance at all to live. His first operation was almost 19 and a half hours long.
Nearly a year after saving Tom Norris's life, Mike Thornton would be awarded the Medal of Honor, America's highest military honor. But Norris was still in the hospital.
When Mike was to receive his medal, of course, he wanted me to be there. And we went to the hospital and said, you know, I'd like to be able to be at this ceremony. And they felt that was, I mean, medically, I wasn't supposed to be doing that. So they said, yeah, you can't do that. Of course, that's not the thing to tell. You just don't tell a SEAL he can't. You know, it's not a word in our vocabulary. And so we...
I just went up there in the middle of the night.
Mike, he did. Mike kind of kidnapped me out of the hospital.
The Navy got so angry at me because I ended up keeping Tommy for 4 days instead of one day. I told Admiral Zumwalt I didn't leave in North Vietnam, and I sure as hell wasn't going to leave in the hospital on that great day. I never forget, President Nixon said, "Mike, what can I do for you?" I said, "Well, if you could break this medal in half, give the other half to the young man standing behind me," because he saved my life too.
4 years later, President Gerald Ford awarded Tom Norris his own Medal of Honor for the rescue of the two downed airmen. Once he and Mike Thornton both had received the medal, it would be the only time in modern history that one recipient had saved the life of another.
Neither one of us feel that we deserve our medals. He may think I deserve mine because he sat next to me now, but did I ever think about it twice about going back to get Tommy? No, because I knew that he would have done the same thing for me. And that's what type of trust that you have within each other to do missions like that.
The last SEAL advisor left Vietnam in March of 1973. With another war ending, the special warfare units were once again imperiled by budgets and bureaucracy.
The worst time I can remember is post-Vietnam. We actually took United States Navy SEALs out of the teams and put them back in the fleet. At that time, the brain power said, well, we probably don't need that much special operations. That was a terrible mistake, and a lot of guys suffered for it. So I think the darkest time in the 45 years I've been associated with this community was post-Vietnam, just because the SEALs weren't valued.
Funding for the military, including the SEALs and underwater demolition teams, dropped off quite a bit. And there was a very low period where it was difficult to get the supplies you needed to even train properly. We got a lot of training done, but we didn't get a lot of shooting done because we didn't have the money for bullets at the time. Skills atrophied or were not developed with the times. That went on for a number of years after Vietnam.
But special operators would still be needed. In 1980, President Jimmy Carter approved an Army Special Forces rescue of 53 Americans being held hostage at the U.S. Embassy in Iran. The rescue mission, however, met with disaster. When a helicopter collided with a C-130 troop carrier that was refueling, 8 servicemen were killed and several others injured. In order to avoid another catastrophe like Desert One, the military created 2 new organizations. A Joint Special Operations Command to coordinate all special warfare missions, and SEAL Team 6, the Navy's dedicated counter-terror and hostage rescue unit. They chose the number 6 to make the Soviets believe there were 5 other teams working against them. While now considered the elite of the elite, SEAL Team 6's first combat mission met with tragedy.
Early this morning, forces from 6 Caribbean democracies and the United States began a landing or landings on the island of Grenada in the Eastern Caribbean.
When President Ronald Reagan gave the go-ahead for Operation Urgent Fury, he expressed concern for the safety of 600 U.S. medical students on Grenada. But the underlying concerns were, once again, about the spread of communism. The country's Marxist prime minister had been gunned down by even more radical members of his Cuban-influenced administration. Grenadian military forces had been augmented by Cubans and other Soviet bloc troops. Reagan saw the prospect of another communist toehold in the Americas as unacceptable and ordered the American military to capture the island and restore constitutional democracy. While this was America's first major combat operation since leaving Vietnam, it was planned in just 3 days. SEAL Team 6 was part of the rushed operation. 12 teammates undertook an ill-planned parachute insertion in heavy winds. Intelligence failed to consider daylight savings time, and a daytime mission faded into night. The men were dropped in the wrong place. 10-foot swells and a driving rain dragged the men and their parachutes. 4 SEALs perished that night. Other SEALs were able to save the Commonwealth governor, who went on to stabilize the country. And the mission in Grenada was hailed by President Reagan as a triumph over communism. But the operation exposed the need for better joint special ops communications and cross-service training. The SEAL community did some soul-searching.
If it was a training exercise, we would have canceled this, but we can't. This is real world, and you go. And so you look at those things, and you know, you talk about it in very gloves-off terms, not to assign blame, but how do we train ourselves, or how do we prevent this from happening again? Because had we made the better decision, this would not have taken place. We wouldn't have lost those people.
The SEALs had been fighting communism since their inception, but the threats were shifting in the 1980s. There were Islamist militants who held Americans hostage in Iran. Then the war on drugs flared, and President George H.W. Bush sent the U.S. military, including the Navy SEALs, to capture Panamanian drug lord Manuel Noriega in December 1989. Six weeks before that, however, the Cold War took a turn. The Berlin Wall came shattering down. Much of the history of the 20th century is written in the struggle for dominion between communism and democracy. There is no more enduring symbol of the Cold War than of the Berlin Wall. Even in pieces. Erected in 1961 as a permanent border between East and West Berlin, it was designed to keep East German defectors from leaving the communist bloc and heading west. Although the wall was down, the U.S. military continued preparing against its traditional enemy, not knowing the extent of an ongoing Soviet threat. So the men just kept training. Cold War training.
Foxtrot Bravo, this is Alpha Charlie.
We worked with the Norwegians and the Germans, and we did crazy stuff like the border of the Soviet Union on skis. And we would go out on patrol for days and days, living in the Arctic, you know, below zero, thinking we were gonna stop the Soviet invasion, I don't know.
But as the threat of war between the Soviet Union and the United States declined, a new enemy was on the rise. Al-Qaeda. In its first attack on America, the terrorist organization bombed New York's World Trade Center in February 1993, killing six and wounding 1,000. This was the same year that Osama bin Laden issued a fatwa, urging his followers to kill American soldiers stationed in Somalia as part of a United Nations humanitarian mission. Bin Laden provided military training to Somali tribes opposed to the UN's intervention.
My first actual combat mission was in Somalia in 1993. I was a member of Task Force Ranger, which was a joint special operations task force that went overseas to Somalia to capture Mohammed Farah Aidid, who happened to be one of the warlords in control of the area at the time. They were taking control of the food, which was causing famine for a lot of people. Innocent civilians were dying. And before we had actually deployed over there, they had actually killed a group of Pakistani soldiers and massacred them. So our job was to go in there and try and capture them. I was part of a small SEAL sniper team of four guys, very close-knit. And our specialty was sniping off of helicopters. We thought that that's the skill set they needed in Somalia. When we got on the ground, though, it was a different story. The Army was in charge, rightfully so. We were only four SEALs, and they decided to use their guys in those roles. So we just took it upon ourselves to find a job. You know, that's what SEALs do. We weren't just gonna sit on the cots at the airport.
Rick Kaiser and his teammates from SEAL Team 6 successfully carried out several snatch and grab missions in Mogadishu, intent on capturing Aidid's top lieutenants on their way to the warlord himself.
The SEAL utility vehicle, right, was our transportation, even though it was not armored at all. It was very dangerous. So anyway, we went in to reload our magazines, get some water, and get ready to go out. And I went to the bathroom, and when I came back, all the guys were in the Humvee already, ready to go, except for one place, the driving seat. And I looked at him, I go, you bastards, you know, because that is the worst place to be, is in the driver's seat, because you can't shoot. You got to just drive. You're just like wide open, especially with no door and no armor or nothing.
You got the good seat.
But they all looked at me, and I could just see them. A couple of guys were behind the sandbags going like this, you know, laughing at me. And I was like, man, didn't pay to go to the bathroom. So before the big battle on October the 3rd, we had already conducted, I think, six other missions, all of which gave us, I think, overconfidence that we could do whatever we wanted in the city. That the enemy was not that fierce. But unfortunately, you know, as events unfolded on October 3rd, when we were doing another typical mission to go into a city, to a hotel in the heart of the bad guy territory, one of our helicopters got shot down.
Then, Islamist militants shot down a second U.S. helicopter. But the men trying to rescue the embattled Americans also got trapped. 99 U.S. servicemen were now stranded in the middle of the city, surrounded by thousands of armed fighters. This operation was memorialized in the book and movie called Black Hawk Down. It was not widely reported that four Navy SEALs worked with Army Rangers to rescue their downed soldiers.
So we were in a gun battle from about noon that day until noon the next. We took wounded guys in, and we went back out and fought some more, took some more back in, and then we went out a third time to rescue the guys in the helicopter, and we did. We finally got them out.
Although 18 Americans died in perhaps the fiercest firefight since Vietnam, every SEAL who was in Mogadishu earned a Silver Star for valor in combat. But the brutality of the battle was broadcast, and the U.S. withdrew. Known as the Mogadishu Effect, fear of public humiliation underscored many future U.S. foreign policy decisions. But a loss for America was taken as a victory by Al-Qaeda.
What we found out later is that that was really a test bed for Al-Qaeda and other Islamic militants for the future, because what they saw us do was when the going got tough and Americans got killed, we left. So it really gave them the courage to carry on and fight us, you know, all the way up to 9/11.
September 11th, 2001 was a new generation's Pearl Harbor. After that deadly attack on America in 1941, there was an obvious enemy and a nation to hold responsible. Sixty years later, 9/11 was different. Terror had no government.
In the operations department at Dev Group when 9/11 happened. We were standing in our operations center watching it happen on the news.
I was in the Pentagon when the airplanes flew into it. I was where every good team guy needs to be when the cockeye hits the fan. I was in the gym working out. And I heard the fire alarm go off, but we'd had numerous such drills, and I thought it was a drill, so I casually got dressed and I went out, and as I stepped out, I saw 25,000 of my closest friends leaving the building, going down to the river. What the hell happened? They said, we think an airplane hit the building. My response was, I gotta find my boss. He needs me now. So I fought my way back into the Pentagon and was inside the Pentagon and actually sitting right there with the Secretary of Defense and my boss while they were trying to figure out what the heck was going on and how many more airplanes were going to come in and were going to hit what.
I didn't even believe it. What do you mean they're hijacking planes? He goes, yeah, there's terrorists that have hijacked planes that are crashing them into buildings. And I'm like, what?
You know, our intelligence agency, we're tracking terrorist organizations, and it just felt like it was just a matter of time. You had already had some of these attacks overseas, the barracks in Saudi Arabia, the bombings of the embassies in Northern Africa. Then you had the USS Cole, and it was like, these things are coming more quickly. Change the course.
So I was a sniper at that time, and I was the ordnance rep, and I was in charge of all the platoon's firearms, all of its weapon systems. So I said, sir, what do you need from me? And he goes, obviously you've heard, you've seen what's going on downstairs. You know, we're packing, so load up everything. And I just turned to him and I said, what are we packing for what? And he looked right back and he goes, we're going to war, take everything.
USA! USA! I can hear you! The rest of the world hears you! And the people who knocked these buildings down will hear all of us soon.
What changed on 9/11 for us, I don't think we realized it until probably 2 years into it, that it changed us from a reactive force into a long-term, long-range fighting force. Whereas before, we would go for quick missions, a week or two, go rescue some hostages, go take down a ship that's been taken over, that kind of thing, and we'd be home and happy and everybody'd be, you know. But now we were like, this is the long haul.
Fourth or fifth day after 9/11, got a brief from commanding officer telling us that we had been selected to go overseas. He'd been given national command authority to send one SEAL platoon, and he was going to send our platoon. And like, you are happy that you're going, but you feel bad for the guys in the other platoon. And I remember leaving and I was like, oh man, sorry you didn't get picked. And one guy looked at me, he's like, you dude. We were allowed to go home for one night. We basically got about 7 or 8 hours off to go home and say bye to our families. And then we filled out last will and testaments. We filled out life insurance paperwork. We filled out power of attorneys for all of our families. So it was the real deal.
It took about 4 weeks after 9/11 before we knew what the government wanted to do. We just kept training like we normally train and got ready.
The general consensus of the population is that SEALs hide in a cave somewhere. When the bat signal goes up, they show up, and they save the day, and then when they get done, they go back and they attach their feet to the ceiling and they go back to hanging upside down. Not really the case. What they're doing is they're going back to training.
Training is as close to realistic combat conditions as is allowable.
Move!
You always shoot live rounds in the SEAL teams. There's very little blank training. If there is, it's only just to kind of get some of the basic moves down before everything turns into live fire. And so all the rockets are real, all the rounds are real. What it's fostering in you is your ability to react under extreme adversity and to be able to clearly think under a lot of stress. So, you know, when bombs are going off and rounds are flying and, you know, you hear man down and next thing you know you got to do buddy drags and you're doing all these things, what that is doing is allowing you to remember that you have to stay focused and the last thing you're supposed to do is panic.
The Taliban must act and act immediately. They will hand over the terrorists, or they will share in their fate.
Shortly after 9/11, SEAL Team 3's Echo Platoon headed to an unknown destination in the Middle East.
We were the first SEAL platoon to deploy from the United States that I'm aware of. Well, we didn't know where we were even going. Then it wasn't until we had gotten to altitude that our officer in charge asked one of the air crew, hey, where's this plane even going? And he was like, we were told we're flying you guys to Kuwait. We're like, all right, Kuwait it is, you know? I mean, what are you gonna do? You're not gonna leave, you know what I mean?
The men had hoped they were going to the heart of the fight in Afghanistan. But their disappointment would soon diminish. Chris and his teammates were assigned a maritime mission called VBSS, Visit, Board, Search, and Seizure of Smuggling Vessels. A couple of weeks into their deployment, a drone in their area identified a Tier 1 target related to Osama bin Laden's earlier terrorist attacks.
It was the ship that Al-Qaeda used to smuggle the explosives into Africa for the two U.S. embassy bombings that killed over 200 people. And so they wanted that ship taken down, and our platoon was given the green light to do it, and we were just like, wow. No one says anything, right? And all of a sudden the joking, the grab-assing goes away, and it's game time. So, you know, unzip the bags, put all the gear on, press check the weapons, make sure there's a round in the chamber. And we raced up at 40 miles an hour in the middle of the night, hooked and climbed up the side of the ship, jumped over the railing. We probably had about four or five people that had already made it over the railing, and we were setting a security perimeter when the doors opened and people started coming out. At that moment, we couldn't even wait for the rest of the platoon, so we started the assault on the ship with four or five people. There was a seriousness about what we were doing that I hadn't experienced before. The professionalism rose to the challenge, and all of us just never really said anything, never talked, nothing. We just operated. So that ship takedown took about 3 minutes.
In October 2001, SEALs were among the first U.S. forces to set foot in Afghanistan as part of a true joint special forces operation.
There were a lot of folks who initially asked the question, what are SEALs doing in Afghanistan? Well, SEAL is an acronym for sea, air, land. That's just how you get to work.
I can tell you the first time that I ever touched down in Afghanistan, it was a very surreal feeling and experience. You know, you feel like you've trained and worked so hard and so long for something, and now the time is here. You know, all your blood, sweat, and tears you gave in training, you're going to get ready to test that overseas somewhere for real. But it was, you know, exciting and a little bit scary all at once. You know, I landed at night shortly after September 11th, and it was the time had come.
Although Osama bin Laden would not claim responsibility for the 2001 attacks on America until 2004, U.S. intelligence quickly assigned blame to Al-Qaeda. They had also known that the Taliban, fundamentalist Islamists based in Afghanistan, had been harboring Al-Qaeda agents for years. Early in 2002, the U.S. and coalition partners launched Operation Anaconda, the first major initiative to capture or kill Al-Qaeda fighters and their Taliban supporters in Afghanistan. Before the operation began, U.S. intelligence agencies concentrated satellites and other spy technologies on the valley where the initial attacks would be staged.
Despite focusing what one officer at the time called every national asset on the Shaikot Valley, the intelligence estimates turned out to be wildly off the mark. Rather than 100 or 200 Al-Qaeda fighters concentrated mostly in the villages on the valley floor, there were probably several times that, and a lot of the positions they occupied were in the high ground overlooking the valley and therefore overlooking the landing zones that the helicopters carrying the U.S. infantry were going to land on.
A Delta Force Lieutenant Colonel Pete Blaber was in charge of advanced force operations.
Blaber's gut told him that it was important to get U.S. eyes on the ground before the main assault force went in.
Blaber had two of his own reconnaissance teams and requested a third from SEAL Team 6. The five-man unit was codenamed Mako 3-1. It was led by a SEAL reconnaissance expert named Goody.
Blaber pulled Goody aside and told him, the success or failure of your mission will predicate the success or failure of the entire operation. You have to get to your observation post by H-hour, the time that the operation officially starts. Goody was determined not to let labor down, so he told them that if they were falling behind schedule, they would just keep dropping gear, if necessary, until there were five naked guys with guns standing on the OP at H-hour.
Shortly after dawn, on March 1st, 2002, Goody sent the other two SEAL snipers on his team to scout their predetermined observation post.
When they finally poked their heads over the rocks to take a look, they got the shock of their lives. Right there was a tent occupied by Al-Qaeda fighters on the very spot that they had wanted to put their observation post.
Everything changed when Mako 3-1 moved into position. In addition to discovering enemy fighters, the SEALs also identified a Dishka heavy machine gun on the ridgeline, an anti-aircraft weapon with a range of about 1,000 meters.
That was the exact path that the infantry assault helicopters were going to fly in just a day or so to start Operation Anaconda.
Airborne surveillance had completely missed both the men and their equipment.
Until you're on the ground, and until you see it from your own eyes and choreograph everything in your mind, you have to have operators on the ground to pull the sensitive things off that we need to do.
Goody's plan was to wait until just before Operation Anaconda was to begin before assaulting the Al-Qaeda tent. This would diminish the risk of other enemy fighters in the area being alerted to their presence. The SEALs took up a position behind some rocks, only about 20 meters from the Al-Qaeda tent, and watched.
As the SEALs waited, an Al-Qaeda fighter emerged from the tent and wandered over towards their position. The fighter let out a shout to raise the alarm, and at that point, Goody gave the order to attack. The SEALs came over the ridgeline firing. Somebody inside the tent fired off an entire clip. They took the tent under fire.
The SEALs killed two of the five Al-Qaeda men and wounded a third. Goody's team called in an AC-130 circling above the firefight to take out the remaining Al-Qaeda fighters, ending the threat to U.S. helicopters, which would enter the valley less than 2 hours later.
Our guys made the right decisions, and they took care of the threat. If they had not been there at the right place at the right time, the beginning of this event would have been a lot different than it was. Averting a disaster? Yeah, probably.
In the first phases of Operation Enduring Freedom, SEALs carried out 75 of these special reconnaissance and direct action missions. While team members would fight in Afghanistan for the duration, early on, their commander-in-chief opened a new battlefront against a familiar enemy. The SEALs would, once again, be amongst the first to operate. March 2003. The United States was poised to invade Iraq. Congress had granted President George W. Bush the power to wage war after the Bush administration argued that Saddam Hussein had failed to disclose his arsenal of weapons of mass destruction, or WMDs. The administration also accused Hussein of forming alliances with Al-Qaeda. Former U.S. Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld later admitted that they eventually discovered the intelligence underlying their WMD estimates was false, and confiscated Iraqi documents would later reveal that there were no direct ties between Al-Qaeda and Hussein's government. But in March of 2003, all branches of the United States military were preparing for the offensive. On the eve of the Iraq invasion, the SEALs undertook what was, at the time, the most complex operation in their history. Their mission, to capture Iraq's enormous southern oil supply. Without allowing an economic or environmental disaster, as had happened in 1991, it was considered essential that the oil supply be taken over before the invasion began, before the Iraqis could destroy it.
The first Gulf War, the first thing that Saddam Hussein did was blow up his southern oil infrastructure. And what that did was dump millions of gallons of oil into the northern Arabian Gulf, which created massive environmental impact.
Over a decade later, it was the SEALs who were tasked with keeping Saddam Hussein from destroying the country's oil supply, as well as the entire region's environment and economy.
The way that oil flows off southern Iraq is it gets pumped from this large pumping metering station to two nodes, which you could think of as almost faucets on the very end of the Al Faw Peninsula. And it's through those faucets that oil runs to these two terminals, Kayat and Mabot. And these are massive. Each one is about a mile in length.
If the Iraqis had a chance to destroy any one of five critical points, it would coat the northern Arabian Gulf with oil.
We had to have boots on the ground in each one of those five locations at exactly the same time. And so we started our planning, you know, months in advance of how we would put SEALs on board these two terminals in the event that there may be rigged explosive devices. We were getting intelligence from different places that suggested that there were arms and explosive devices on at least one, if not two, of the terminals. What started out as a much smaller, isolated mission expanded into what became a very large mission all the night before the war started.
The day before H hour, it had just the oil workers on it. So at that point, it was just going to be go and secure it and get those people off of it. Kind of no big deal, and then we'd hold it and secure it and turn it over to someone else so they could, you know, no one could get on it. And the day before, we noticed all of a sudden all those guys were getting offloaded, and they were bringing Iraqi bad guys, and they were bringing them on. They had an anti-aircraft piece that they brought on. It changed quickly.
The team's nightly reconnaissance had revealed that tugboats would patrol the perimeter of the oil platforms, cruising a long circuit around each of the terminals. There were also large rings of light from searchlights on the Mabot and Kayat.
The plan was we would get all of our assets outside the light ring of the terminal, and we would wait for that tug to go around. And as soon as the tug passed us, we'd send three ribs carrying SEALs and a Polish Special Forces team very quickly through the light underneath the platform. And from there, the guys would scale up.
The operation began at 10 p.m. on March 20th, 2003. More SEALs were deployed for this one mission than ever operated together during the entire Vietnam War.
We had helicopters where I was, overhead, looking at it with the FLIR, which, you know, I could see what was going on at like 2,000 meters. And then once we were up close circling the thing, providing security as snipers. And then I was up there also working the radios, pushing the timeline along and the execution checklist along.
Clockwork was so important. It was so important to get guys there. Every part of the mission was so interlocked, and if someone got there early, there was the potential to put folks in danger.
I told those guys were feet on the deck on that thing. Anything that moved or acted stupid on it was going to get shot by myself or my partner in the other helicopter.
The SEALs successfully got aboard the platforms, safely secured their prisoners, as well as the weapons they discovered. The entire operation took about 45 minutes.
One thing we know is that, unlike in the first Gulf War, we prevented, you know, the destruction of millions and millions of gallons of oil. You know, we prevented that environmental disaster.
Within hours, the United States invaded Iraq. The invasion immediately toppled the regime of President Saddam Hussein, who quickly went into hiding. Although he was the number one fugitive in the country, there were over 50 top-tier targets on the most wanted list. So a group of soldiers came up with the idea of a deck of cards, ranking the missing outlaws by the face value of the cards.
The deck of cards, well, they started at the ace of spades, which was Saddam Hussein, and then they went down, you know, to the twos, down on the bottom somewhere before they started the rest of the blacklist. And And that's how we knew them. You know, it was easier than pronouncing their name.
SEAL teams and other special forces started taking cards out of play. There was only one woman featured in the deck. Huda Sali Mahdi Amash was better known by her nickname, Mrs. Anthrax.
The Five of Hearts was a female who was part of Saddam's. He was her main, chemical, biological weapons gal. She was moving around quite a bit from safe house to safe house. And the intel that we got on her, we needed to move fast. And we figured that the best time to take her would be while she was in a vehicle when her security detail was smaller than it normally was. We had such a small amount of time for mission planning on that one, and that's the magic of the SEAL teams. That's just the way we do it, you know. If it needs to be done, we'll do it.
In December of 2003, U.S. troops and a Special Operations Joint Task Force captured the Ace of Spades. But the arrest of President Saddam Hussein hardly ended the war in Iraq. As it persisted, more SEALs were engaged in Operation Iraqi Freedom than in any other war in their history. SEAL teams adapted to being unconventional warriors in a conventional war. For the first time, they truly fought side by side with their comrades in the Army and Marine Corps. It started in a place called Ramadi, center of the insurgency. Al-Qaeda in Iraq declared this city to be its capital.
When we got into town, we began to interface with the conventional forces, the Army and the Marines. They're the ones who own the battle space, not us. And so we very humbly said, hey, look, you know, you guys own this battle space. You tell us how we can help serve you. What's going on here? Where are your bases? Where are your outposts? What's this area over here? And there's an entire area. I mean, I remember this distinctly. They said, this whole area right here is Al-Qaeda-controlled battle space. Don't go there. You can't go there, nobody will go there, but nobody will come get you.
We got him over here.
In the past, the SEALs often did not work very well with conventional forces. SEALs had their mission, and it was like, this is our mission, we can't tell you what it is, and we're gonna go do our thing. And our task unit commander had a much different philosophy on things. And we said, well, what are you doing? What can we do to help? And guess what? We integrated an interface with them, and it was a mutually beneficial relationship, right? Rather than us having to coordinate how to drive all our guys into a mission, the Army guys would give us a ride in tanks. Man, that's a heck of a lot better than a dang Humvee.
Andrew Paul was a lieutenant with a task force of 32 SEAL snipers.
As something would happen, we would come in and we would go grab these guys. We'd go out and do an overwatch operation, and these guys in masks and guns would come out to attack an Army patrol, and you know, our snipers would whack all four or five of those guys all at once. Over the course of 6 months, we had over 360 confirmed kills. That's just our task unit. That area that was Al-Qaeda controlled battle space, we owned it by the time we left.
Go in.
When you're interacting with the local populace, you are an ambassador of America. And you know, not everybody feels that way, but I felt that was important. So, I mean, I would talk to them. I'd ask them, you know, where they're from. I'd tell them about my family and where I'm from and why I was here. You know, they'd first probably see this guy's come in with all this gear on, and I mean, they would be very afraid. And that's not what we're there to do. My idea wasn't that we were there to go terrorize Iraqis. My idea is that we're there to go relieve the country of Iraq. You can only shoot so many guys. You can only, you know, blow up so many things. You can only do so many missions. You know, sooner or later, our mission really is to give this back to the people of Iraq.
When people think of SEALs, they think of them kicking in doors, doing the very offensive things. Yeah, that's true. But I think where the nation gets their most bang for the buck is in that diplomatic problem-solving type guy who can work with partners to expand their capabilities and their capacity and prevent wars.
There are a lot of guys who we can train to go shoot people in the face. But what SEALs and Green Berets and Special Forces do are work in that full spectrum of conflict and being able to go from drinking tea to step outside the tent and go do something that a commando needs to do and then go back inside the tent and drink tea some more. And that is a unique skill set. But what's going to make them SEALs is they've got to be able to do both.
At that moment in time, it's, to me anyway, it wasn't ever about God and country. You know, it was about being with your brothers, it's about operating, it's about doing everything you could to make sure they could come home to their family.
In September of 2006, in Ramadi, a 25-year-old Petty Officer Second Class Michael Mansour was on his first combat deployment as a Navy SEAL. Mike had failed his initial attempt at SEAL training, but persevered and ultimately made it to the teams.
Mike Mansour was one of our platoon mates who lost his life in Iraq, and he jumped on a grenade and saved two guys, one on either side of him, and he subsequently got the Medal of Honor. Mike leaves behind a big hole in my heart, but I'm proud of what he did, and I'm proud of what that stands for. This idealistic warrior. Mike had sent an email to his sister the night before saying, "Gear's packed, I'm on my way home." Yeah, it's pretty rough.
Andrew Paul was already back in California when Mike Mansour was killed. He was one of the men to notify the Mansour family.
Got our blues together, got our plan together, and drove up to find his parents' house. And man, that was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. I remember the commander who came up with us said, "You know, Sally Mansour," she said, "Yes." She goes, "Well, we have some news about your son." And her head just slumped against the door. And I mean, I just watched the life drain out of her.
Look at Section 60 at Arlington National Cemetery.
Ready.
It's full of SEALs. Men who've sacrificed and given their lives. The enemy gets a vote, and nobody's immortal.
At SEAL funerals, there is a tradition of teammates removing their insignia called the Trident and embedding them into the coffin of their fallen comrade.
You're not just burying a warrior, you're not just burying a teammate, you're burying somebody that you love, somebody that you know, somebody that you trained with. You know his family, you know his children. For those of us who wear the Trident, everybody refers to each other as brother, and that is not just an expression, that's how everybody feels about each other, because my teammate's more important than I am.
Poseidon, the god of the seas, wielded a trident that gave him the power to both create storms and calm the waters.
Being a SEAL and the Trident, you come from a long line of people who've sacrificed greatly to get you to where you are. Nobody who wears the Trident today earned that reputation. They inherited that reputation from the men who came before them. While you have the opportunity to be a SEAL, what you have to do is keep that reputation intact and make it just a little bit better than when they put a trident on your chest.
I think we're flesh and blood, but there is something extra inside us. And the enemies of this country need to fear that, because there is something different they don't know about. And the bonds to our brothers is incredibly strong. It'd be like a parent losing their son. It hurts a lot, but it doesn't stop us. In fact, if anything, it just makes us stronger. We'll obviously go to some pretty extreme measures if we need to. like flying in helicopters that you've never seen or heard of in your life into a country that we swear we'll never go to in the middle of the night, crash one of them and still kill you. I mean, you know, it's just, yeah, that's the SEAL teams, what can I say?
On the night of May 1st, 2011, 23 SEALs crammed aboard two stealth prototype helicopters. They lifted off for a 90-minute flight deep into the forbidden airspace of Pakistan. Despite the unusual location, for the members of SEAL Team 6, this kind of raid was a typical one. Except for the target, Osama bin Laden. As SEAL Team 6 descended on the compound, one of the helicopters got caught in its own rotor wash and crashed. The SEALs scrambled from the wreckage and began moving toward the house. The second helicopter landed safely outside the walls. Quietly, the SEALs advanced. On the third floor, they found and killed the world's most wanted terrorist. Over the radio, the SEALs reported Bin Laden was dead. The news of Bin Laden's death brought celebrations to the streets of the United States. But it also haunted the world with memories of a clear September morning a decade before, when the streets of America were choked by terror. This man's death was personal.
I grew up in New York City. I watched the Twin Towers go up. But I also know the traffic pattern of the Hudson River. And I saw the second plane flying south. And I just said, look at that guy. He's not supposed to be flying south there. He's just taking a look at the first tower. And then I saw him go into the second tower. I saw it when it happened. And immediately I said, we're under attack. I finally got home from work around midnight on 9/11. And my phone rang. And I picked up the phone, and there was a voice, extremely emotional and crying, and said, Joseph, I know what you do. Get them. Get them for what they did. And it took me a couple of seconds to realize, it's my brother. And on the 2nd of May, I placed a phone call to my brother. I said, it took us a while, but we got him.
All across America, people gathered in spontaneous celebrations outside the White House at Ground Zero to Times Square.
I got numb. I felt chills. He was the face of terrorism and the driving force behind a lot of stuff, but it felt like victory.
Bin Laden was the embodiment of the Western world's newest enemy, the leader of an international network of splintered cells, nearly impossible to infiltrate. His was a shadow leadership that took shadow warriors to end. No official state, no traditional command and control centers, no uniforms identifying an enemy combatant. Bin Laden's death symbolized the fact that America had adapted to fighting this new kind of adversary. And the Navy SEALs became the embodiment of that change.
We are what they're scared of. We're their, that bump in the night. That mystique and that legacy goes way, way back to even Vietnam and before, you know. The enemy knew the men in green faces, or if they were coming for you, you weren't coming back.
When you're out there and you're in a conflict, or a tick is what they call it, you're fighting for the brotherhood. It's the guys on your left and your right. The real reason and the political reasons why you're there, and that's all going to be argued on left and the right of the aisle, somewhere in Congress, somewhere, guys in the barbershop, people driving down the road, you know, on their Bluetooth headsets. But when you're in it and it's happening, it's about this man. I'm not firing my weapon to make sure that I come home alive. I'm firing my weapon to make sure he comes home alive.
I never thought about killing people because I always thought about it as a mission. My job was never to go out and kill somebody. My job was to go capture somebody, go collect intelligence, go do reconnaissance. Because you kill somebody, you don't get any intelligence out of them. You capture them, you're going to get something out of them. So eventually, And then, you know, we can plan our next mission, because that's what every SEAL wants, is the next mission.
I think there's always going to be SEALs in one form or another, but I think there's still going to be the same basic sort of guy who trained right down the road from us here in Fort Pierce during World War II, the same guys who fought in Vietnam, in the mountains in Afghanistan, and in Iraq.
The innate thread, I think, that goes through the teams since their inception, way back to World War II, is what I call the Rudy factor. If you remember the Notre Dame football, they have hearts that they just will not quit. They will not quit, no matter what. They're the type of guys who can get knocked down, get back up, get knocked down, and get back up. That's the common thread.
Since World War II, SEALs and their forefathers have faced whatever threat the enemies of each generation have posed. From Hitler's beaches to Bin Laden's terror, while the perils have changed and will continue to, the invisible men behind the face masks still claim a common heritage and future. No matter how sophisticated they or their foes become, they are simply frogmen.
We live in an extremely dangerous and difficult world, and no matter where we as a nation go next, the first people in will be the SEALs.
Navy SEALs, Their Untold Story is available on DVD. The companion book is also available. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS. Navy SEALs, Their Untold Story is also available for download on iTunes.